Being a founder is like walking on glass, staring into an abyss. The statistics for fashion as a contributor to global pollution is staggering. It accounts for more than air travel and shipping combined. Shopping secondhand is economically a no-brainer. Anything that I bought secondhand, I can sell on for the same price I bought it, and then it's net zero. The Cirkel is an online resale platform for menswear. You can use our services to sell through us. It's a fully managed, hassle-free service, or you can shop from us. We try and make the experience of online shopping for secondhand feel like new.
I'm just fascinated about your experience on Made in Chelsea.
Yeah, I was, as a 20-year-old, quite insecure, and I just wanted to be liked. So I didn't dare do anything too controversial. With social media, it's where it's a blessing and a curse, is you're always looking left and right, and everyone seems to be doing everything. I did care a lot about what people thought about me.
What do you struggle with the most? Quick question. When did you discover that you're a leader? That your actions matter to those that look up to you. You may be an entrepreneur or an aspiring entrepreneur, innovating to change the world, or a CEO navigating a crisis, or a parent returning to work and learning to lead your career, your team, your children. There are many faces of leadership, and this is the podcast to explore them all. Welcome to Anatomy of a Leader with me, Maria Vorostovsky. I'm a headhunter and founder of HVO Search, where I help ambitious leaders hire their executive teams. My job today on this show is to help you discover your superpowers, to help you avoid making some of the same mistakes, and to remind you that even if you do, perfection doesn't and shouldn't exist. Thank you so much for listening, and please do subscribe and follow this podcast because it really helps others to discover these incredible stories. This show will challenge the way you think and may even change your life. Eliza, welcome to Anatomy of a Leader. Thanks so much for being on the show.
Thank you for having me.
Before we go and talk about Cirkel, I'm just fascinated about your experience on Made in Chelsea.
It's always the headliner. it's hard. It's still something that's very relevant. I think because it's still running as a show, people are still have quite a lot of interest in it. But for me, it's funny because it was 5 years ago, which is 20% of my lifetime ago.
Wow.
So so it feels sort of like a lifetime ago. But I did it through second year of uni. I was at Durham. The opportunity came about because I was messaged by a producer on Facebook and I replied and then got, you know, back and forth, and next thing I knew I was on it. But as a whole, it was a up and down experience. It can be quite hard, reality TV.
Yeah.
But it was a lot of fun. People on there were a lot of fun, and it has opened, it's offered a lot of stepping stones to other things, which I'm very grateful for.
You were saying that you were very young when we went on the show.
Yeah.
So didn't have that kind of grand plan about what it was going to do. So
yeah, I think everything's funny in hindsight, isn't it? And looking back, if I could do it again, yeah, I'd played the game a bit more or got more out of it. But honestly, I was just doing it because it was an opportunity. I played it very safe, actually. I was, as a 20-year-old, quite insecure, and I just wanted to be liked. So I didn't dare do anything too controversial. I never swore on it. Probably could argue I was not the most entertaining television, actually. But if I could do it again, yeah, I'd probably use it to make more of a platform, and then it would help maybe open more doors.
So what would you do differently?
I think now that I'm more secure within myself, I wouldn't care so much what everyone else watching thought of me. So therefore would speak my mind a bit more and not bite my tongue or not question everything I was saying. But then on the other hand, I've come out relatively then unscathed. I don't know. I haven't sold as much of my soul, but then I haven't gained as much as other people. So.
Right. I think that's the conversation that happens in everyone's head. It's just not everyone's in front of the camera.
Yeah.
And so, you know, like, oh, should I say this? Or, you know, how should I, if I do, how am I going to be perceived? You know, holding yourself back.
Yeah.
I mean, what would you have said or done differently, do you think?
Oh God, I can't think of necessarily specific. Actually, no, I can think of one where I was dating a guy and he was dating someone off the show at the same time as me. And she came on the show. He didn't know. And then I was given the opportunity to say my mind. And I was so aware that my grandparents would be watching it that I said, instead of you went and fucked me up. But like, I didn't swear at him. And in real life, I would have sworn at him. Mm-hmm. And instead I went, you went and pooed all over it. And I look back at that and I'm just like, oh God, that is, you know, just, I was so aware of not swearing because that's where my grandparents were going to watch it.
Yeah.
People that have done the best out of it have not held back. Right. So that's just something I would say to anyone going on it is like, if you want to get them, you get out what you put in. That's it. But that's with everything, isn't it? You get out what you put in.
No, for sure. I mean, you were so young to do that. And, you know, just to be on camera and being seen and and be in a position where you will be judged, that in itself is, you know, some form of confidence. Like when I watch you on it and I think, wow, you know, she's, you know, really got it together. She's, you know, she knows what she's doing. She's quite forward and direct. And it does come across that you say what you think.
Yeah.
So it's interesting to hear that, you know, on the inside, it looks and feels different to what it could
be. Yeah, maybe. I mean, honestly, it's so, I think that's probably a bit of retrospective reflection as to what I perceive, because perhaps now I'm more direct or more, maybe that was just how I was at the time. But I do just remember thinking, you know, you'd film for an hour or something and just think, just concentrate for this hour because it's going to be on telly. So just don't, also don't be not interesting either. There's an element of don't just sit there and say nothing because it's telly.
Yes.
And you know, when you can sometimes have those tired days and you're sat in a conversation of friends and you just want to be the listener.
Yeah,
you can't do that when you're sat, when you've got cameras in your face, a bit like now. But no, on the whole, it was a great experience and it put my name on somewhat of a map.
How do you think the experience changed you in, so to speak, real world? Or has it changed you?
It probably has, but I wouldn't say in it. It's so hard to say what I'd be like now, having never done it. I definitely wouldn't be doing the Cirkel. I wouldn't be sat here doing this podcast. I don't know if I'd found another avenue to be relevant, but it was, that is the avenue of relevancy that I've gone down. But I think it's probably changed me, good and bad. I did care a lot about what people thought about me, and I was always, especially at the time being at Durham, which was such a bubble, I was aware that people did talk about it. But then on the other hand, that's grown me a thicker skin as well. And now I don't mind it as much.
So once you finished the show, what happened then?
Lockdown. I sort of stepped away from the show to enjoy my last year of university because I felt that yo-yoing to and from London and Durham for a whole year detracted from the university experience. And university is so finite and I'd made such amazing friends and I really wanted to just throw myself into it. But then three, four months in to third year, we were called home. So the show halted anyway. And then as lockdown eased, actually it didn't ease for ages, did it? But when I was finishing my degree and thinking about what I wanted to go into, I was on the path. I really wanted to go into documentary making.
Okay.
That seemed to me like an obvious crossover between, I studied anthropology, study of humans, and TV experience. That to me seemed like where the two collided. So I applied to do a master's at City University of London to do TV journalism. And that's what I did the year after university, which was actually still locked down. So a lot of it was remote.
Mm-hmm.
But that was a brilliant course, full on, full time. But you learn everything to do with journalism. Mm. So that was really interesting.
What's the main thing that you feel like you picked up?
I think, again, you learned, you had voice training and you had how to talk directly to a camera. My worst thing that I really had to work on though was pieces to camera. So when you're doing live telly and you're talking to a camera, I'm better at learning a script.
Yes.
So I found that quite hard, you know, trying to my facts and figures and not stutter along it.
Yeah.
But that's always good practice. And particularly now doing the Cirkel, where obviously our social media and everything is quite outward facing. And I spend my days talking to not necessarily as smart a camera as these, but my phone camera or whatnot.
Yeah.
in today's world, being able to talk to a camera and communicate through a screen, I think is pretty useful.
So much of our world now is visible online. Mm-hmm. Like, it's almost the expectation that if you have a brand or a product or anything to do with, you know, addressing at least, you know, large group of people, that you have to be visible, and you have to be visible as a founder as well. Do you feel like that?
I think yes, because I came from a place of visibility, perhaps. Mm-hmm. Being the founder of the Cirkel came from a place of a social media presence, came from a place of, yeah, reality TV. And, you know, all the sort of back end degrees and the hard work, that's there, but everything has been front facing for me. So that was, I'm aware of my role and responsibility and that added value mm-hmm. when it comes to being a founder.
Mm. So talk to me about the Cirkel.
Yeah.
What is it? And why did you start that?
So the Cirkel is an online resale platform for menswear. And you can use our services to sell through us. It's a fully managed, hassle-free service, or you can shop from us, where we try and make the experience of online shopping for secondhand feel like new through the use of models and photography, which I believe is the way to convert more people to shopping secondhand, is to make it feel really luxe and elevated. And I started it, so throughout university, I used to buy to sell clothes on Depop. That was how I made my money. Did it through when I was filming in Chelsea. I was always sourcing clothes from eBay, charity shops, and then flipping them for a profit. And that's just how I made pocket money. And it was good because it was freelance. You could turn it off when you had lots of essays to do. And then, I've got a free day. Let's make some cash. So I really enjoyed it. And I've always loved shopping. So it was a way of...
You were a pro already.
Yeah, well, I could then shop. I could spend my time trawling through shops, totally guilt-free. And then in lockdown, I changed that Depop shop to a charity shop. So I built a platform on Depop and I thought, let's sell clothes to raise money. Originally it was for Trussell Trust, but throughout the year of lockdown, it changed charities every month. But it became people were doing massive wardrobe clear outs, nowhere to put their clothes because all the charity shops were closed. So I saw a bit of a gap there. So I just took everyone's donations. We raised £12,000, sold 2,500 items. I mean, my God, it was a slog, but it gave me something to do and it had a purpose. And I really enjoyed it. So that then bled into when I moved into London, I had a bit more disposable income. I got into shopping secondhand, but a bit more luxe. Mm-hmm. So there are lots of little boutiques dotted around London and I sort of was working on uncovering them. But then also thought I need to promote these because everyone should be shopping here. Why are people going to Zara or the high street? They need to come here. This is so cool. You can access these incredible brands. And I'm a bit of a magpie. I do like a brand, but I could never afford it. So I was thinking, here is a place I can access them. And so I came up with a series on Instagram called Secondhand Saturdays. So I've always, you know, that's a very long-winded way of saying I've always had a foot into secondhand in one way or another since I was probably 19. And it was actually doing those Secondhand Saturdays that my now co-founder discovered me because he had the idea to do a business and he was looking for a partner to do it with.
Right. How did he discover you?
He just was doing market research on some of the other secondhand shops and saw they had reposted some of my promotional stories. And he saw that I was good at talking in front of the camera, good at selling the items. And then actually it was only when we had our call and then he found out all the other Depop stuff and the fact that actually I'd been selling clothes for a long time. He just thought, oh my gosh, it wasn't just that you could present an item. You've done it. You've done the back end. Mm-hmm. You know that it's a slog. Selling clothes is an operational slog.
In today's age, by just following your passion, doing the things you like, and then also having that visibility that you can find your, you know, co-founders or be found.
Yeah.
I think that's so interesting.
I think I always played it down as well. I think I would often say to my friends, oh, you know, it's just luck. Like, it was just luck. But actually, they will always reply and say, you're doing yourself a bit of a disservice. You put in that time. You didn't just happen to be in a shop filming a story and then you land the job as a co-founder. Like, you have the experience that got you there as well.
Yeah. Well, that saying is like, you know, I'm get luckier the harder I work.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
And the more you put yourself out there for opportunities.
Totally. And it was right time, right place as well. Yes. There is a bit of that. But yeah, totally. You've got to make your own luck.
I believe that there are some people who are just terribly unlucky, and there are people who are lucky, but there is also that in between where it's not just completely up to the fates to determine what your next steps are. You can still put yourself in the position, but you just never know at which point it's going to happen.
Totally.
So you need to be completely ready to make that work. So
no, and Secondhand Saturdays, that whole series was an unpaid spending a day going to a shop, trying on loads of outfits, creating the content, putting it out there. There was no financial incentive for me, and it was a commitment and investment of time, but I knew it was something I was interested in. I didn't know where it was going to lead me. I would never in a million dreams have thought it'd be leading me to my own business. I did remember saying to my housemate one day after filming in one of the shops, and I came back and I said, oh, I would love to have my own shop. How fun would that be to have a shop? And she was like, well, you can have a shop. And obviously now the Cirkel, we're going for a bit more than a shop. But it is, I do remember thinking when I was doing this, oh God, it'd be so fun to be on the other side of this.
So how do you feel now going from, you know, having that idea and that dream to like doing it?
I feel excited. I feel tired. I feel sometimes overwhelmed. Very privileged, but also very determined and motivated.
So talk to me about the tired part and the overwhelmed part.
I think it's, I mean, I don't want to cop out and say anyone who's had a business knows how it feels, but it's a different ball game, I think, to just having a job, because you're emotionally invested as well as just the financials.
Like it's your baby.
It is literally your baby. And I don't have a baby, so I don't have the that to compare to. I'm sure my co-founder actually had a baby last week, and I'm a bit jealous of the baby because I'm thinking now he's going to love the baby more than the Cirkel. that cringe saying of blood, sweat and tears, you put everything into it. And so there's a lot riding on it. The thing I find hard is, obviously, the team are wonderful and brilliant, but I find it hard that they won't ever care about it as much as I'll care about it. So I think the tiredness comes from just you're constantly on an overdrive. And perhaps that's also, if I'm being self-aware, relative inexperience in terms of how to separate the two. I think that might come with time, or maybe people never do. I don't know.
It's really interesting because it's something that I talk a lot about with founders at later stages, or, you know, for example, we had a conversation with the founder of Feel Unique, which came out, a few weeks ago, and talking about work-life balance. And he was talking about how in the early days, you know, it was really fun. Lots of things were happening, and literally like every single moment of your time, you're just dedicating to the business, to the point where you're starting to neglect your social life, your health, your mental well-being. And it does lead to a place where, you know, you're like, actually, this is not what I wanted, and I'm feeling overwhelmed, burnt out and tired.
Yeah.
And then making a change and putting more boundaries into place and exercising, you know, eating well. And I asked a question to another founder who is Dr. Sam Skincare.
Yeah.
And she was talking about how she felt very anxious very early, and it's always about, you know, performance and getting things. And I just said, well, would you have got to where you are if you hadn't felt that way? And if you hadn't, you know, put in the time, put in the work? And said, well, I actually could have been even in a better place, because then I would have perhaps made different decisions or just felt good about it. And there is something to it where, in the beginning stages, you are working so hard and, you know, you really put all of yourself into it. And the startup, things break. There's not enough resources. There's never enough time. And you don't know what that 20% that you're supposed to be like focusing on is until you have a little bit of time to kind of figure it out. Yeah. But ultimately, I think creating that space and creating that balance, does make you better because it helps you to think clearer and operate out of abundance rather than fear that you're running out of time or if you don't have enough things. So yeah, I think it does come from experience, but also not just your own personal experience, but experience of what works for your business and what doesn't. So I think this idea of, you know, that sort of startup, you know, lean startup model where you test things, that makes a big difference to figuring out what doesn't work quickly and not to do that.
Trying and testing for sure. I think I definitely haven't let the social life slide yet, but perhaps that time for me, or you talk about like exercise and healthy eating, that's gone. Don't have time for that. But I'm definitely still in that. I'm still really trying to make the most of my 20s. But it is hard. I think also with social media, it's where it's a blessing and a curse, is you're always looking left and right and everyone seems to be doing everything. And you feel like you're in a bit of a rat race.
How do you manage that? But you're obviously aware that you're paying attention. And you're aware that it's a rat race. And yet still it's something that's impacting you. And I find that fascinating about human beings. Like, we know that comparing yourself to others isn't good for us. And yet we're just almost like compelled.
It's so funny. And I do sometimes think when people... They say that some people can be quite outspoken and empowering about, I don't compare myself to anybody, and I'm so happy with the way I am now. And I'm thinking, really? How? You know, is that legit? You never, ever have a thought that comes into your head where you think, oh, God, what are they doing? Oh, God, what are... That would be very liberating.
It would be, and it is. And it's... I think we as human beings are... wired for social comparison because that's what keeps us safe and together as part of the tribe. So if we're too different from the tribe, then, you know, we're kind of like the outcast. And we also are compelled to want to move up the social hierarchy, except that in today's world, social media has opened up the social hierarchy to the most elite people. And the average person, and I'm not even saying, you're not an average person by any means, but comparing themselves to the most successful, like 0.01% of the world is very difficult, very challenging. So I don't know, as human beings, how we can be more disciplined to be, well, I know this affects me, but this is not empowering for me. What can I do that actually will empower me to move forward? And I think that comes down to believing what you're doing is important, that you're doing it for yourself rather than for kind of like the perception of it. I think, I mean, I'm
not totally, for validation. I think you need to stick clear on what your purpose is, for sure.
But it's also really hard because, you know, for example, if you work with social media, you are exposed to it. So it's very difficult to block everything out. Like you'll post, you know, I'll go to post, you know, the clips of the podcast on Instagram. And then before you know it, I'm sucked into looking at all of these things. And I'm like, wait a second, no, I'm supposed to be, you know, posting my own things as opposed to just like, you know, consuming others. So it's just it's hard.
I think also I do try and remind myself, if I was coming onto my Instagram page as a new, fresh pair of eyes, they would probably perceive me how I perceive others, in terms of I look like I'm doing everything and it's go, 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 and it's all great and fun. And so I think that helps to remind me, because I know that there's a lot of that, but there's also a lot of a lot of the unglamorous, just boring moments in life. I think people are so scared of just sitting and doing nothing or being bored because everyone seems to be doing something. So then I try and remind myself when I do go on a new page, is that's what people would be seeing going onto my page. And I know the backstory. So I'm just going to assume that they have a backstory as well. That's not as glamorous.
Do you think we should be posting the unglamorous and the boring things?
I used to, but now I don't want to, literally not even the case of trying to put on the perfect picture at all, but I just actually, the unboring and the unglamorous, I don't then want to be thinking Instagram is then sort of a job. Like for me, the unglamorous and the unboring, I want to just disconnect from my phone or not get distracted by it. Because actually, even just that filming the boring bit is partaking in the social media bit. Yes. Does that make sense?
Yes. So it's like saving something for yourself.
Yes.
Yeah.
And I used to be much more film absolutely everything. And now, firstly, I don't remember to. I'm not nearly as good on my social media as much. But so only when it's the good bits, I'm like, oh, this is great. I want to remember this. Mm. But I don't want a film to remember me sat going through emails. That's so boring.
It's so true. It's so true because I think of how I do that, you know, how I post on things. And if I'm feeling in a good mood, that's when I feel like, oh, yes, yeah. These are the things that I want to capture on camera. As you said, I don't want to be sitting there and, I don't know, filming myself when I'm like in tears or, you know, having like a really bad moment. It's also the time for reflection.
Totally.
Yeah.
And also then I couldn't even imagine sort of having a good cry and then whipping out my phone because I think I'd then change. It wouldn't seem like an organic cry anymore.
Yeah, no, I do find that very awkward to watch when other people on social media, because it feels, I don't want to say it's not genuine, because I'm sure these people are experiencing pain, and not to say that everyone is making this up, but there's something different about being with somebody who is in distress when you're face to face with them, where you can give them some kind of a comfort, as opposed to seeing someone on a screen crying. Because what are you as an individual who is primed to feel something for the person who is in distress? Like, what can you do as an audience? And I think that barrier is where I think it becomes very tricky for me.
I just know I'm not cut out for it. However, I have seen accounts where people are very open with their trauma, and it does feel really genuine and very candid, and actually I feel great comfort from it in a strange way. So actually I really respect the people that can do it. I just know that I would almost be taking three takes. Yeah. And it's just a genuine,
like Margot Robbie crying.
One didn't work, let's go again.
You're right,
because... but I do respect it. You know, it's so important to have those accounts out there that are just so honest.
I think there is also a difference between a person who is in distress that needs help in the here and now, as opposed to a person who's in distress saying, look, this is reality, this is what happens, and this is for your benefit, for you to understand that these are the realities of life and that we all go through it, and this is how you can heal and help and expose maybe an issue that hasn't been talked about before to the extent that it needs to be. So I think that there's a difference between those two. We're talking about being on camera, being revealing yourself, being vulnerable. Going from TV to then going into a startup, what has surprised you most about being an entrepreneur?
Good question. I think in a way, everything has been a surprise, because I wouldn't say I went into it blindly, but I don't know many entrepreneurs and I don't know many co-founders. And it's all well and good asking people for their experiences, but everyone's experience is unique. I think how the role evolves every month, every week, every day is really interesting. I found at the beginning as well, it's funny, people think, oh my gosh, you're a founder, that's so glamorous, but actually you're the ones that are taking out the bins, making sure that the room's hoovered. You do absolutely everything.
Oh yeah.
So I think that perception I find quite funny, that people perceive it as, and I'm sure one day it might get more glamorous and that would be lovely. But right now we're still just past our year birthday and I will still do the hoovering. That's just how it is. Also, becoming a manager, I found, has its own challenges, because obviously you want to grow the team, and that, you know, growing a team means a growing business and it's all really exciting. But how my role has now evolved into more of a managerial role comes with its own challenges.
What do you struggle with the most?
I think perhaps an element of, I'm aware, I think sometimes I have imposter syndrome, because I am a appear to my lovely team. And I sometimes feel a bit impostery when I'm play boss. But you know, wing it, fake it till you make it. my team are so great and I love that we have a really good relationship. But I think it's just when it comes to the more serious chats, I think I put on a good, I hope they don't listen to this, I'll know all my secrets, but I think I'm quite put on a good front, but I'll be the one that's sat there sweating from the armpits thinking, oh my God, quite nervous about it. Mm. Serious chats.
Yeah, difficult conversations. Yeah.
But whereas my co-founder, who's in his mid-40s, water off the duck's back. He's like, we need to have this chat. Let's have it now. Okay.
They're so important. One of the conversations I was having about, you know, the relationships between the co-founders and the ability to resolve conflict, which all boils down to having those difficult conversations.
Totally.
I don't think they ever really get easier because it's always tricky to talk about something that you disagree with. But I do find that when, and I say co-founders, I think in any relationship, romantic, co-founders, business relationship, or a management, you know, even if you're a boss of someone or the other way around, which is probably the most difficult one in terms of managing upwards. But that ability to have difficult conversations and to say what you want to say without attack and without it being, without betraying your own needs.
Yeah, yeah.
I think those are the conversations that have to happen. But it's interesting that you say that. I'm going to challenge you on the bit that you said about being a peer, though, because I don't know how many people would have, you know, gone out, you know, been on TV, set up their own Depop page, you know, created the back end. You've done a lot. Like, you've managed to do a lot in your time. So, you know, having that experience, maybe not management experience, but entrepreneurial experience and sort of putting yourself out there, and to be accountable and to be visible, that not many have experience of that.
Yeah. And I think with my team, I always try and hire people that I think are better than me. Mm-hmm. But it's funny. I know also then it highlights where I do lack in things like my organization definitely needs improving. I'm not the most organized person. If you were to look at my email inbox, you might have a heart attack.
Don't worry. Whereas, I don't even look at it sometimes. Yeah, and I'm like,
it's just, it's a lot of unread emails. It's a lot of mess. And saying on top of that, that's something that I have to really work on. But that's where you hire someone that's like got the organization down to a key. I think I'm trying to come to terms with, I don't have to be the best at absolutely everything across the board of the business. I want to hire people that are better than me. That's what's going to be best for the business. Mm-hmm. But yeah, I think when I do sometimes have that doubt of when I can see my colleague's inbox and it's all folded and categorized and I'm thinking, oh my God, what am I doing? I'm her boss. That makes no sense. Then I think, yeah, I have to remind myself of those points that you very kindly raised.
I don't think you have to be good at everything. No. You just need to be good at the things that you're good at.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Niche.
What is that niche for you?
I think communicating. I'd like to think that I'm a natural communicator. I've got the right balance of empathy when it comes to, I think I'm quite emotionally aware of other people and how they're feeling. And in terms of social situations, I'll always be picking up on things. So I know when is the right time maybe to pull someone out and just check if they're okay. So I like to think as a manager in that sense, I'm aware of how my team are feeling and they know that it's always an open door if they want to come talk to me. Mm-hmm. I am quite a good salesperson.
I can see that.
My dad, who works in insurance, always said I'd be a good broker, but he said I'd find it too boring. If I believe in something, I can sell it to most people. But then on the other hand, I can be quite relentless because if I do believe in something and someone's disagreeing, I can't, I'm not one to back down. It is the best, I promise. I'm very much, if you don't ask, you don't get, but I also don't take no for an answer. And that's something I just need to sometimes just know it's all right, you can step back now.
I think it's a really great quality, especially early days, because you get said no to all the time. And it's the ability to persist and persevere and be like, no, you know, this is important. So that's how you make things happen, because like rejection is everywhere. And, you know, that ability to be just like, no, actually, you know, this is very important. I need to get this.
And I'm glad it's found a purpose or a value, because I can tell you at home, it drives my family up the wall. So I'm glad it's I found an avenue where it can be put good to,
I think it's
to
a
good
great
use.
Quality. My daughter, who's 5 years old, I mean, she's like that. She will just not let things go.
Yeah.
And I'm like, good.
Yeah.
Good. Like, you know, my husband's not so keen on that, but I'm like, just keep doing that. It's such a good quality in life to like go for it. What's the best piece of advice you've received?
I've used it now, but if you don't ask, you don't get. Despite always acting on it by default, if there's ever an opportunity that comes about, or you even bump into someone on the street that you recognize, just talk to them, make that network, make that connection, because you never know when it's going to potentially come back around. So I think in terms of making sure you take all opportunities, just say yes to as much as you can without obviously overwhelming yourself, because you just never know. And a lot of things will be dead end. That's fine. But a lot of things will lead to a gold mine.
What's your main challenges for Cirkel now?
With any startup, and particularly in your first year, you're never on dry land. So you've got the simple challenge of swimming and just to keep swimming. Our next challenge will be just our next raise, but that's not for a little while. We closed our last funding round and we've got a good time for run rate. That's really exciting, and I feel there's a little bit off my shoulders. Obviously that burden will gradually increase, but for now we're in a good place to just kick on for the second year. But I'm aware of the challenges that will be incoming, and in terms of scaling, you know, it's a business that is quite operationally heavy, and making it as efficient and as automated as possible, because I really want to be able to scale it. So that will be the challenge, I think, the scaling aspect. But I think we've got the right tech team and idea behind it.
So where do you see the business in, say, where do you see yourself in 5 years' time?
This is the hardest question, because I've actually always been a very short-sighted person in terms of me, where I am. I find it so hard to see myself even next year, let alone 5 years. We have ideas of where we want. And funnily enough, me and my co-founders have probably slightly different ideas, but that comes from their own experiences with their own businesses. And, you know, this is my first business, so mine is a bit more vague. They've had, one of my co-founders was one of the co-founders of made.com. So he's seen a business scale to IPO at 700 million. And then obviously drop off and go into administration last year. Luckily he had left, but so he has that experience, which shapes his idea. My other co-founder has seen he was in a startup team that literally skyrocketed in the first year. It's ridiculous. So he sees things moving quicker than perhaps Julian, who's seen his business grow a bit more slowly. So I'm sort of somewhere in the middle. But ideally in 5 years, God, I'll be 30. Hopefully in a good place.
Looking backwards now and giving advice for young entrepreneurs thinking about their first idea, what advice would you give them?
There's a saying that my co-founder told me, which I found quite funny, also not funny, but it's a bit dark, but essentially being a founder is like walking on glass, staring into an abyss. And it's walking on glass because it's what you're doing, there's a lot of pain, it's a lot of work, you're doing a lot of things you don't want to do, all the unglamorous bits. It's staring into an abyss because you're sort of always constantly running out of money and you don't know when it's going to end, and you just feel you could fall off the cliff at any point. So my advice would be, from that saying, is you have to do something you really love and that you really see the purpose in, because it's pretty soul destroying if you've got the pain and the abyss and you're not really loving what you're doing day to day. And then in terms of a business thing, I think it's finding the cheapest and fastest way to see if there's an interest in your product or service. And by doing that by surveys or online, Instagram polls, it'd be pretty tough to be pushing a business that there isn't that interest in. Mm-hmm. So you've got to be sure that there's going to be demand out there. Because otherwise, imagine doing the abyss and the glass and there's no interest.
I have to say that this abyss, it's so true. And I think experienced founders, they know that that's the case. But majority of the time, especially when you're a first-time founder, the reason why you get into it is because you have completely no knowledge of the glass or the abyss. Yeah. And it's this power of naivety where you have no idea what you're getting yourself into and how hard it's going to be. Mm-hmm. And if you don't know that in the beginning, that's what actually encourages you to start. Yeah. Whereas if you knew, you wouldn't have started anyway. Yeah.
I think that's where I'm really lucky to have my two co-founders who have been through it before.
Yeah.
So I feel like I've got mentors in them, which is great. And I do have utmost respect for young people doing it all by themselves. Having that team really helps.
For sure. What I see is that the business success depends very heavily on the team, and being a sole founder is exceptionally challenging because not only do you not have all of the skills that are required, it's also the psychological aspect of carrying all of the weight on your shoulders.
Totally.
And having a really good, well-matched team makes a world of difference. Going back to the Cirkel and its principle of, you know, secondhand fashion, you know, creating more of that circularity, making it fun. Talk to me about the sustainability angle and what you're hoping to achieve with that.
Yeah, I mean, the statistics for fashion as a contributor to global pollution is staggering. It accounts for more than air travel and shipping combined. You know, people give people stick for private jets, but actually your shopping habits are a big contributor as well. So for me, it was finding a way to make the right choice also the best choice. So the most fun choice, the most accessible choice. And I think that comes across perhaps in our marketing and how we present ourselves. We're not there holding a green placard in your face saying you must shop at the Cirkel. We're trying to make it as if you were shopping at Net-a-Porter, so that people can still get that fix, because unfortunately we are an addicted society to shopping. And
newness.
It's so easy. Mm-hmm. Yeah. And it's just there at a click of a finger, and everything's so elevated and lovely. And so we're trying, whenever we think of our competition, it's like how we present ourselves, we want to feel like new. Mm-hmm. Obviously there are going to be limitations to that, because everything's a one-off and it's not all brand new season designs. So it's never going to look exactly like a Net-a-Porter, but we can push the limits as far as they will go. And then also people have to start shopping secondhand. There is also a statistic that makes it much more digestible, is if everyone had just 20% of secondhand items in their wardrobe, the impacts of that would be really, really positive. So it's not, I'm not saying everyone has to do entirely secondhand, as lovely as that would be. I understand that that's not realistic, but it's about making those tiny little changes that then can hopefully become a habit, breaking the cycle, essentially. So yeah, it's really important to make our platform as accessible and as easy as possible. So there's almost no excuse not to.
It's staggering what we have available, and yet it's about changing the behavior as well. And it's like tapping into understanding the customer of how they go about their day to day to then, you know, change the mind about, you know, going for just like those new items.
Totally. Yeah. And also you're talking to a shopaholic who back in the day was on Zara every week. So I've been there.
Me too. Yeah, I've been there, done that. Yeah. You know.
God, yeah, it makes me feel a bit nauseous looking back, but I was terrible. I'd also order absolutely everything I'd get my hands on to send back 95% of it. Just ridiculous.
Guilty.
Just had no thought. Whereas now it just, yeah, can't do it. But I understand not everyone. And the other really tricky thing, actually, but this could be a whole other kettle of fish, is making them, you know, for us as a business, making the margins work whilst also being really accessible. And I understand that not everyone will be able to access our platform. There is going to be, say our lowest price is £35 for an item, that will be outpricing some people. I'm aware of that. I hope that's not the case forever. I hope when we scale, we can have even more. But that's just a tricky thing that who am I to say who should be able to access fashion?
Mm. What's your vision for what sustainable fashion shopping should be?
I think just more platforms, you know, like us, but also different. I think having the apps on the phone that people can do it from their home if they want to do it themselves, that's really cool. Basically, more platforms where people can keep their pieces circulating. Mm-hmm. And I suppose some people will have to buy new to inject more clothes into the circular economy. Mm. Because, you know, our clothes won't live forever. But it's about increasing each item's lifespan to as long as it can. Because you may have tapped out of the item psychologically and it doesn't hold value to you anymore up here, but it still holds value. It's an item that can be used and loved by someone else.
Yeah, it's so easy to just buy something that, you know, you bought spur of the moment, or even if you did think about it and, I don't know, you had a baby, you've put on some weight, or you've done a color analysis and all of a sudden you realize that's the wrong color for you.
And I don't believe in color analysis.
Do you not? No. Why not?
I just think it's a bit old fashioned. I just think wear a color that makes you feel, it doesn't matter. You know, if you put something on and it terribly washes you out, but if you love the color, just wear the color.
I don't know if people know. And I say that with, you know, I used to paint, so I felt, I was like, oh, I'm really good with color, but I realized that I'm not, because it's less about figuring out what is the best color for you and more about the process of even experimenting and putting colors next to your face and trying to like realize what you enjoy.
I just think if I got told I couldn't wear XYZ and then I had to, and I looked, they were in my wardrobe, and I think maybe it's just a self protection method. I just don't want to have to get rid of anything.
I haven't done it professionally, but I have gone and used TikTok as inspiration to try to figure it out. And it was really eye-opening because I realized that a lot of stuff that sits in my wardrobe and the things that I don't wear is because they don't suit my body, whether it's
shape, I think, is important.
Shape and also color. And I'm like, oh, that's why. But before I didn't have that knowledge of, and I think the average person has no idea what they're doing.
Yeah.
So I think there's a lot of clothes that just sit there with their tags still on.
The average is in the UK wardrobe 11 items with tags still on.
I'm surprised. Like, I would even say that's probably, I mean, that's
in the
average,
wardrobes,
right?
That I've seen, that's the average. Yeah. And some of the wardrobes that I go to, it's like, whoa.
Yeah. So putting those back in there, and I think as a, you're talking about shopping your wardrobe as an individual who likes clothes and knowing that your clothes hold value, that you can just resell them rather than that's it. This is it.
Because one man's trash is another man's treasure.
Well, just keeping items thinking, well, I can't get rid of it because I've paid for it. So it's the sunk cost fallacy. Yeah. Like, it's mine. And if I get rid of it, that's it. Yeah. You know, money kind of gone. Yeah, but it's just taking rent money in your closet and it should just be passed on.
And for me, shopping secondhand is economically a no-brainer. It's savvy. Pretty much 90% of everything I buy is secondhand. The odd basic I might buy new, but anything that I bought secondhand, I can sell on for the same price I bought it, and then it's net zero. So 90% of my wardrobe is now net zero because I've bought it for a set price. If I can keep it in the same condition, it doesn't reduce its value. The value's already been reduced from the initial purchase and then wear. And then it just plateaus most of the time anyway. So for me, I can then circulate my wardrobe in the secondhand market and not really lose any money. So I now do not spend any of my salary on new clothes. My source of income for clothes come from selling old clothes.
I think that's a really nice way of looking at it because then you've already invested into it.
So I've made the initial investment. It was bigger than I realized when I was going through my wardrobe at the very beginning. I was like, oh my God.
Do you have stats about how much average wardrobe costs?
No, but I wouldn't want to know mine.
I'm so curious to know because it's like, as a woman especially, how much of your income has gone into your wardrobe that you only wear, what, 10%?
Yeah. It's under a third, definitely, that you wear in a year. But for if people aren't so bothered by the sustainability aspect, they could potentially be bothered by the fact that it makes so much sense financially.
What are the pieces we shouldn't buy new at all?
Denim requires so much water. It's staggering. Liters on liters, thousands of liters of water. And denim wears so well. You know, vintage Levi's that are 40 years old, people are buying in thrift shops and wearing them and looking really cool. Denim wears the best for sure. And we get loads of jeans in because people change sizes I feel with jeans, they're a bit of an enigma. I think people are always looking for the perfect pair and they don't exist. So you're always chasing the perfect pair, but yeah. It means that you get bored of old pairs. So we do get a lot of jeans coming in, and that's something I'd always recommend buying. Also, from a financial perspective, they lose their value. You buy a pair of A-Gold jeans for £250. On the resale market, they don't go for much more than 70. But when you've bought them for 70, you can sell them for 70, buy them for 70, sell them for 70.
I see.
But if you bought them new, they'd lose their value quite quickly. So I'd say denim is definitely a no-brainer to be looking at. And also, jeans don't change other than like skinny. There's not millions of styles of jeans. Jeans are jeans.
Fashion does try to make you go down, you know, you just got used to skinny jeans. Yeah.
And then it's the next thing. Yeah. They don't need to come back, actually, skinny jeans. They can stay in the abyss.
I don't know. I'm an older millennial who was like,
love skinny jeans.
Lived in skinny jeans. And then after two pregnancies, they don't fit me anymore. So it's like, well, you might as well look for new pairs of jeans.
Yeah.
But
denim makes sense.
Yeah. Where do we find the Cirkel?
Find the Cirkel online at www.thecirkel.com. I should also spell it because it is a quirky spelling. It's Cirkel. Don't ask me why. That was my co-founder. but you can also find us on Instagram, and we do quite regular pop-ups. So if online shopping isn't your thing, and I do know it's not everyone's thing, we do offer the opportunity to come in and sort of see the clothes in real life.
Which I still need to go to. I keep missing them. So I'm very, very excited to go. Well, Eliza, thank you so much for coming on the show.
No, thank you for having me.
Such a pleasure to talk to you. And very excited about the rest of your journey and what you end up doing. I know.
I'll come back on next year and we'll see if there's any differences.
We have to. Great. Thank you.
Thank you so much for joining me here on Anatomy of a Leader. What were your takeaways? And if you haven't already, I'd love for you to subscribe and follow this podcast. And I'll see you in the next episode.